Jim, that was a fantastic sight to be able to visit that stone. A hermit priest in Clay County, Kentucky. Well, we've got proof, haven't we?
He was here.
He was sure there. Tell us a little bit about the stone, the translation, if you would, Jim.
Well, the Ogham script was used in the Gaelic tongue. And the translation is something like this. It says, "Do not sulk or be downhearted," which is good advice, isn't it?
It certainly is.
And he went on to say that to sing joyous carols is more becoming to a priest.
It's uplifting, right?
And the last word is music. The next to the last word is obscure, and they didn't know how to translate it.
Well, you know, if you put yourself, I kind of sometimes like to sit down and think of him being there in solitude. And when you listen to the sound that was there, is it not music?
It is. It really is.
The water, little waterfall, does not just roar off there. It hits different spots on the thing, and it's kind of like music. It actually, an ear that can distinguish tone, it changes tone, and it's almost like it plays music. It is certainly a beautiful place. And
When you view this world in faith, it does sing. It cheers you up. No doubt this man was a little downhearted and depressed, which we all get sometimes, you know. Mm-hmm. We get out of focus. Mm-hmm. Like when Peter was walking on the water, he was doing all right, and he focused on the waves, and he got discouraged. And that happens to us, and I suppose that's what happened to him.
Right, right.
And that lesson still holds.
Nothing new under the sun.
Right.
There's nothing wrong for a person having a bad day.
And a man that can sing in an environment like this, in a lonely, isolated place far from Ireland, he had to have faith, didn't he?
He certainly did. He really did. I'll tell you, just walking this hill back up here, almost in this generation, you've got to have faith for the climb.
It inspires me to know that no matter how far that you're away from home, and how strange the environment is, that the Lord is still with us.
He certainly is. I noticed behind us here something that's in the wintertime, things are a little harder to spot. Tell us, what is this we have here, and how plentiful is it in this area?
This is the cane, and this is what was such in abundance in the early days in the river bottoms that form the cane brakes. This is what the buffalo fed on. And when this first comes up here, it's very tender, just like a bamboo shoot.
It looks like bamboo to look at it.
And the buffalo fed on this. They had trails through it. And this is the cane brake. And nowadays, people mostly use this for fishing poles.
Well, it would make a good one.
And when they're allowed to grow in certain spots, they'll get up, you know, make a great big pole.
Well, we sure love Clay County, Kentucky, Jim. We thank you for having us here.
that up.
One of the reasons probably that nobody's seen it before is the ground level was up right about where you put you up to high that it'd be hard to
now
see.
Now right here is this insignia representing the Centurion.
Oh yes, uh-huh.
I'm pretty sure Dr. Fell would say that's what that is.
Mm-hmm. And there's our Greek.
Yeah. And this is an Iberian inscription that he has translated. Right here.
Okay.
Now, whenever the sun shone in here on the solstice, it hit this line right here.
Well,
and these
lines are there.
Well, there's some deep grooves here, but there's only this one line here.
Okay, now usually those grooves. Or so they can tell about how long it is until the solstice.
Is that right?
Where it hits on it, see?
And this
it's
here...
It's like a calendar.
And I'm satisfied this is an inscription right here. It looks like 1939, but I don't believe that's what it is.
A lot of times you'll find a sun symbol right near those marks.
Yeah.
Because that's just like a calendar to them. They can look in there and see where that sun is on each one of those grooves and tell you about how many days it is till it's going to hit center.
Now in the morning, it's 22nd December, we were in the back, as far back as we could get, and right in the middle, as much as we could get in the middle, and the sun, when it came up, was right in the center, okay. Perfect alignment.
So it's a winter solstice cycle?
Yeah.
Shortest day of the year.
Now I've got a tracing of that one that I gave you.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one is just on in there.
Ooh,
right above your hand at the top. Right there. Right above your hand.
If you want to wear these cotton nose, take your hand some.
Yeah, right here.
Hand's cool.
Boy, that is awesome. Awesome.
Yeah, this is what Robert Pyle and his wife both identified as the cult of the head or the cult of the severed head. It's supposed to be a Celtic symbol. He said originated in France. And this represents the muscles of the neck, the jugular vein, a headless symbol. And these are some of the smaller inscriptions here. That's either Iberian or maybe South Semitic. Right here's one of them.
Is that on? Point to that one more time.
Right in here. And right along in here. And this one, and there's two of them right here, and one over here. They look a lot like a South Semitic or old. And this inscription right here, the sun was shining on it the morning of the solstice. Okay. This one right here. And it followed this line here. And Arnold, it looks to me like we've got an ogham right here.
Well, you're just showing me that. It sure looks that way. You got a
right here's a stem line.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got a stroke here that goes down through it.
It's A-M-M. Looks like a triple M there.
What this could, I don't like to say this, but that could say mine, but it probably has to do with fuel in the area or something.
Yeah.
The reason I don't like to say that, if you say the word mine, they go, you know, the ghost rider, digging, you know, there's gold. There. Yeah. Well, it doesn't mean gold necessarily.
Okay, this monogram that we saw before has got right next to it the Christian cross. And this emblem was not, we weren't able to see it before because there was a little moss and silt on it. And because of the great age, I think what this does, this verifies the great age of this inscription.
If you would, Jim, go ahead and translate the whole thing for us.
Okay, now, this right here is the monogram, and Dr. Fell has translated that as Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God the Father. And he dates that from the alphabet around the 9th century A.D. Okay, right here is the pi for Father. And this is the letter key, Christos or Christ. And these other letters are superimposed in there. And in all, there are 7 Greek letters.
Very good.
This inscription here conforms to the letters of the alphabet, the Tifinagh and Numidian. And it was used during the time period of 300 BC to 300 AD. And these letters that we have here were found in northwest Peru on adobe bricks and were identified as such. And it marked a clear, unmistakable connection between the Libyan culture and the Americas. And I've identified around 11 or 12 of the Numidian and Tifinagh letters that conform to the marks on the adobe bricks. And that was in a pre-Inca city in northwest Peru. Now right here, it seems that we have 2 letters from the South Iberian alphabet. This one, it looks like an arrow, and 2 parallel lines here with 2 dots in it. And this looks like ogham strokes that goes with this inscription. And right here is a very interesting symbol. In the ogham, 2 strokes above the stem line is a D. And the word for God in Celtic is D-I-A. And generally, the